Our whole goal here is to advertise the availability of hybrid cars as well as now electric and plug-in electric hybrid cars to help all of us reduce our carbon footprints. So our speaker today is Mr. Paul Scott. He has quite a biography, and I'm going to take the liberty of reading it so that we get all the details right. Mr. Scott is a lifelong environmental advocate. He co-founded Plug-In America, a major group in Southern California, and I encourage you to look at, with no spaces between the words, pluginamerica.org, with all the information you'd ever want to know about electric cars, about plug-in hybrids. He co-founded this organization in 2005 to galvanize, support, and advocate for the manufacture of electric vehicles and plug-in hybrids that reduce America's dependence on petroleum and improve the global environment. As one of the leading nonprofit organizations, most visible leaders, he is regularly interviewed by global media and consults with the auto industry officials, consumers, and local, state, and federal policymakers to advance clean car technology. And of course, it's not too unexpected that Plug-in America is a California organization because of all states, at least certainly Los Angeles and certain other areas in California, they have a pollution problem that completely dwarfs anything which we have here in Wisconsin or in the Chicagoland area. Mr. Scott is regularly a featured speaker at national conventions, universities, schools, and elsewhere. He helped create a very important organization, Don'tCrush.com, which was the predecessor for Plug-in America, a grassroots group that single-handedly prevented, in the early 2000s, some 1,000 production electric vehicles from being destroyed by the auto companies that had manufactured them. And in years past, we've actually had people address how the automobile manufacturers were constructing electric cars without advertising them to anybody here in the Middle West. They were only sold in California and maybe perhaps in Florida too. But all these cars were recalled in the early 2000s, probably by 2002, no later than maybe 2004 or 5, called back and crushed. But with the exception of 328 Toyota RAV4 electric vehicles, most of which are still on the road today. But again, pretty much only in California. There is one in Pittsburgh, but that's a California transplant. Anyhow, Don'tCrush.com was the organization that worked to get Toyota to stop crushing these valuable automobiles so that ordinary Americans like you and me could actually drive an electric car. Well, we don't have that yet, but Mr. Scott will address that. Mr. Scott's work with both groups included campaign strategy, research, planning and execution. He is among the key figures featured in Who Killed the Electric Car? How many of you have seen that movie, Who Killed the Electric Car? Okay, maybe about a quarter of you. I highly recommend that you see that and then also see The Revenge of the Electric Car, which is the latest production reflecting the production of the electric vehicles you will see here today. He was among the key figures in that picture, which was a 2006 documentary distributed by Sony Pictures. And he has been filmed and consulted for the follow-up, which is The Revenge of the Electric Car. Paul works professionally for the downtown LA Nissan as an EV specialist, selling the new Leaf electric vehicle. And I should point out, Nissan, Kaiser Nissan in Madison is the group that are bringing down the Nissan to us here. Mr. Scott did not drive a Leaf from California. He also works as a consultant for SolarCity, the nation's leading residential solar installation firm. He owns a 2002 Toyota RAV4 EV and also a 2011 Nissan Leaf. He is president of the Electric Vehicle Association of Southern California. So without further ado, let me introduce Mr. Paul Scott.
Thank you very much for having me here today. It's very exciting to come into the Midwest and be able to talk about these because I generally speak to people who have been around them for a few years, and it's nice to bring this information to those who might not have had privilege to see the cars or test the cars yet. Just to give you a little bit of background, you know, I grew up in the South, Alabama, Tennessee, and Texas, and moved to Oregon in my early 20s and spent a lot of time up there. Mostly in the environmental world, but also got into visual effects, and that's what led me to California about 14 years ago. And it was after a short bout with cancer that I decided to change directions entirely and get out of the film industry and get into something that I could say at the end of my life, I did some good. And so I got into the solar world and at the same time bought this electric car in 2002, about the time we installed solar on our house. And so as soon as we got the car, we realized we were running our house and our car on sunlight. And we had already gone into Afghanistan, we were just about to go into Iraq, and we realized we had a solution to all these problems. And so it was our efforts to stop the car companies from crushing the cars that already existed, and to get them to build new ones that led me on to the plane that I'm on now. And I feel very good about the efforts that we've done so far. We lost a decade in the process. The car companies didn't want to build them back then, but they do now. Things have changed dramatically. And a lot of the evidence I'll give you for why that is, I'll give you today. So why should you switch to electricity from gasoline? Now, all of you grew up with gasoline, diesel powered vehicles, and it's understandable. It's what you're used to, but there are definitely reasons why you need to switch. You've got pollution. I mean, the pollution that comes out of the tailpipe of your car, you kind of don't notice it as much up here because the weather just takes it away and there's not as many cars here. But if you get about 10 million cars in a small area and you have weather that allows that pollution to sit there for a while, it doesn't take long before you feel it, you taste it. I mean, you feel it in your lungs when you breathe. And Southern California has been probably the most heavily polluted area on the planet for many years, up until the last few years when some of the efforts that we've been doing to clean up that pollution have begun to bear fruit. The pollution, it kills a lot of people, by the way. Just to give you an idea, the studies in Southern California alone indicate over 5,000 Americans die in Southern California related to pollution from automobiles every year. So that's pretty amazing. So EVs are at least 50% cleaner. You know, a lot of people say, well, you're just transporting the pollution from the tailpipe to the smokestack, you know, because you got to generate the electricity somewhere, and they always bring up, well, you're it's a coal-burning car is what they like to call it. Well, yeah, that's true. You've got to generate your electricity somehow. But some like 40 studies have proven, the amount of pollution generated from an electric car charged on the U.S. grid is still substantially less than the cleanest car out there, the cleanest internal combustion car, which is the Prius. So you're still ahead of the game on CO2 and certain other criteria pollutants. But there are even other reasons to switch as well. You know, with electricity, you know, you can generate your electricity from sun, from wind, from geothermal, from a variety of different ways. In addition, you can save energy that you're currently wasting in your house and use that to run your car. In the solar business, I get to see a lot of people's electricity bills, and the amount of electricity that's wasted, especially in Southern California, is just enormous. People could run 3 or 4 cars on that much energy and not have to buy any gas, and their electric bill wouldn't go up. Just stop wasting the energy and use that. And as you all know, I mean, I got off the plane yesterday and driving in with Dr. Rubisky, I was looking at the gas prices. And you know, in California, we're up to about $4.50 a gallon right now. And that's just the standard. The cheapest gas is about $4.50. You guys are still under $4, but you're bumping up against it. And it's only going to go up. It might go down a little bit, but it's always going to come back, and it's going to come back higher than before. And when it goes down, it won't go down as low as it did before. This is what it's going to be doing for the rest of your lives. So you can either plan on paying more and more and more for gasoline for the rest of your life, or you can just stop buying it altogether and go with an electric car, and then you never have to buy gasoline again. You never go to the gas station again. Electricity costs here are about 13 cents a kilowatt hour. You can drive a Nissan Leaf. I get 5 miles per kilowatt hour in mine. The average is about 4. So if you figure out the cost per mile, it's, you know, down in the 2 to 3 cent range. With gasoline, you know, the cheapest gasoline you can buy and the most efficient gasoline car, you're still pushing 10 to 12 cents a mile on that. Plus, you have to pay for maintenance and all these other things that an electric car doesn't have. Electricity price is stable. You know, you're going to have a slight rise in it over time, particularly coal-dependent states and natural gas-dependent states. As we internalize some of the external costs of these fuels, these dirty fuels, particularly if they put a price on carbon, which will happen at some point, then those utilities that use a lot of carbon-based energy will have to raise their price to account for that. So the price of electricity is going to go up. However, because of time of use rates, the demand for electricity during the day is much higher than at night. So your utility will put you on a time of use rate whereby any electricity you use during the peak times during the day will cost more, and at night it'll cost a lot less. Well, it turns out nighttime's the best time to charge your electric car because you need several hours to charge it. You're sleeping anyway, and electricity prices are really low. So at nighttime, we can get electricity for 9-10 cents a kilowatt hour in Southern California, whereas during the day, it can go as high as 30 to 40 cents a kilowatt hour on time of use. So those prices are going to remain fairly stable as opposed to gasoline. When I was a kid, gasoline, the cheapest I bought it was 18 cents a gallon in San Antonio, Texas. And for years and years, it was 20, 30 cents a gallon. And then when it started going up to 50 cents, we were outraged. But now it's, you know, $3.50, $4.50 a gallon, and it could hit $5 this summer very easily, and most likely will. So, and we have no control over gasoline prices. The oil companies want to raise the price. The speculators in Wall Street want to jack up the price so they can make billions of dollars on the margins. They're going to do it, and you have no control over that. You can't. There's no recourse through Congress because they own Congress. So what are you going to do? You're just going to pay the man. But with electricity, generally that's regulated. Most states have a public utilities commission that regulates the cost of electricity, and the utilities, if they want to raise the rates, they have to go through a long, involved process to get that rate up, and they have to prove the need. So that means that electricity prices tend to stay relatively stable. Why should you switch to electricity? Well, electric cars are just better cars altogether. When you drive one, you're gonna know exactly what I'm talking about. You know, when you drive a regular gas car, and you're used to it, so you kind of don't notice it, but you turn it on and it starts vibrating and it makes a little noise. And of course, the tailpipe's emitting this noxious gas that's going to pollute the air. It's old technology. You have a limited torque range, so the power curve on an electric car, I'm sorry, on a gasoline car, in order to get the full power, you have to rev it up to 2, 3, 4,000 RPM to get that sweet spot where you have most power. With an electric car, you've got 100% of your torque all the time. So they bolt off the line. They're incredibly quick off the line. Very fun cars to drive because of that. But the gasoline car, you know, it's you're shifting gears because you have a transmission. It's another thing to wear out, very expensive thing to wear out and have to repair. You're spewing the smog all over the place, and you always have to go to the gas station. And I know you're used to that, and it's just something you do, and it's part of life. But when you stop going to gas stations, you realize that was a big chore, you know, having to go there, jockey for a pump. You know, here, maybe you don't have to spend so much time. And in L.A., there could be lines of people at the pump. And so you have to wait for that. Then you have to get out there and maybe the rain or the cold pump the gas. And then you have to pay them inordinate amounts of money for that gasoline. And, of course, it uses foreign oil. Now, that's a big deal right now because we have to fight wars over oil. We have to spend, we're spending about $400 billion every year for foreign oil. A lot of it comes from Canada, a lot of it from Mexico. But again, they might be our neighbors, but it's our money going to them. So that's a big deal. With electric cars, they're incredibly quiet. When you get into your gasoline car and you shut the door, that's what an electric car sounds like when it's on. So there's nothing. It's just like it's off. It's the same thing. They're very fun to drive because they have so much torque. They're very quick. There's no vibration, no gear shifting. And no emissions. Also, this is a big deal, very convenient to fuel these things. A lot of people talk about how long it takes to charge, but you don't care because you're sleeping. You come home, you plug it in, you walk away. It takes about 3 seconds of your time. None of this going out of your way to a gas station and having to deal with all of that. And most importantly, it uses 100% domestic energy. So you're not spending money out of the country to get your energy. The main reasons to use electricity is the economy. There's three main reasons, but the economy is a big one. We're importing approximately, and this is down now because of our recession and because we're pumping more oil domestically right now. It used to be 60% that we were importing, but it's down to 49% now. But that still represents some 40% of our trade deficit right now is buying foreign oil. It's a huge chunk of money leaving our country. The oil lobbyists, the oil industries, you probably follow whenever they announce their profits for the year, and they're in the tens of billions of dollars every year. The six largest oil companies make tens of billions in profit every year. Now, last year they spent $145 million lobbying Congress, so they prevent any reasonable energy legislation from being imposed on the American people. Not imposed on us, but it's what we need, but they stop it. Mideast instability, boy, if you followed the news lately, Israel and Iran and the Strait of Hormuz, very big deal right now because Iran seems to be hell-bent on building a nuke, whether they say so or not. And we don't know if they are, but all indications are that they do want to build a nuke. And Israel is not going to allow that to happen, period. When Iraq, back in 83, tried to do that, Israel, you know, they waited for the world to take diplomatic action to stop them. Saddam Hussein, you know, said to heck with that and continued building it. And then Israel acted unilaterally. They sent jets over there and they bombed the heck out of their nuclear facility and just destroyed it. So they're not going to allow Iran to build a nuke. They're waiting right now very patiently for the U.S. and Europe and the rest of the world to negotiate with Iran and get them to stop. But, you know, Iran continues. At some point, Israel is likely to attack. And when they do, the Strait of Hormuz is this narrow little point, 40 miles wide, goes from Saudi Arabia over to Iran. And 30% of the world's oil passes through that strait every day. So that strait gets shut down immediately upon the attack. And at that point, the gasoline price is going to go up to $5, $6 a gallon here in your town overnight. And it'll stay that high until the war ends. So that's something you really need to take into consideration because that could happen today, next week, next month. Chances are it's going to happen fairly soon in the next year or two. Pay attention to that one. That's a big deal. Electricity is domestically made. Keeps your money here. Now, in California, we spent $55 billion last year on gasoline. It's a huge amount of money. 90% of that money left the state of California. So that's about $50 billion that we lost out of our economy last year. And you know, California is a big, rich state, but we're hurting economically. And I don't know of any place in the U.S. that's doing really well economically. And if you're sending billions of dollars out of your economy, then that makes you weaker. So if that money were to stay and circulate through our economy, it would create millions of jobs. Here in Wisconsin, I imagine you're sending probably $8 to $10 billion out of your state. You have no refineries here. You know, that oil comes into a refinery somewhere in the south or southwest. They make gasoline, they ship it into your state. You buy it, and all your money leaves the state. A little bit of it will stay to pay for the gasoline station and the people working there. And that's about it. At least 90% of the money you pay for gasoline is gone out of your local community. When you think about how many millions of dollars, just in a small town like Whitewater, if that money stayed here and circulated through, that's a lot of jobs you could create. Plug-in car owners stop giving money to the oil lobbyists, so that's another thing. Instead of giving money to the oil companies and let them use that money against you in Congress, you get to keep some of it, and you can divert some of that money to good causes. I tell my customers who buy an electric car, you know, you're spending on average about $2,000 a year for gasoline. You're going to instead spend about $400 for electricity. So you're going to save, you know, on average maybe $1,500 or more per year. So that's your money to spend on whatever you want. You can spend it on local goods and services, generating jobs in your community. But I ask them, you know, take a chunk of that money, $50, $100, $200, and give it to a cause that you believe in. I give to Planned Parenthood every year. I also give to local animal rescue groups because I like those things. I want to encourage them and help them. And it's money I used to give the oil companies. And when you think about it in those terms, it's not like, yeah, it was your money. But it's money you used to give to the oil companies. You can now divert it to something else and do some good. And when a few thousand people do that, well, that's really good. But think about it when a few million people are doing that. And it's going to make some big differences in how this country is run and what things are supported instead of all that money going to the oil companies. The environment. So this is a biggie also, because obviously electric cars have no tailpipe, so there's zero pollution associated with driving your car. Now, where your energy comes from, that's where the pollution is, but you have that choice. You can sign up for your utility's renewable energy program and use wind energy or solar energy, or if you've got the roof for it, you can install a solar system on your house and generate all your electricity from sunlight to run your house and your car. At that point, you're zero pollution well to wheels. There's nothing there at all, you know, other than the construction of the vehicle itself, and you can't get around that. So electric cars shift pollutants away from the population. So even if you are generating pollution from your electric car by charging it off of a grid that has coal energy, well, the coal plant isn't in the middle of your town. When you're driving your car, you're where everybody else is, so your pollution is right there where everybody's breathing. The coal plant, on the other hand, generally is farther away and doesn't affect as many people. Still bad to use coal, but it's better to shift the pollution away from the population centers. The plug-in hybrid electric vehicle and a battery electric vehicle reduce pollution, can reduce CO2 pollution by 40% to 65%. By 2030, and up to 100% if you're a battery electric vehicle using renewable energy. So that's the goal for everybody, is to get their energy from renewable sources and drive a battery electric car, because then you have zero pollution. And the other thing is the power grid gets cleaner. Every year we're adding more renewable energy to the grid. We're shutting down coal plants. And we're shutting down natural gas plants yet. Right now, natural gas is going to be used as a bridge fuel as we shut down the coal plants before, as we bring on more renewable energy. So the grid's getting cleaner in spite of the new electric cars coming and demanding more electricity. Gas cars get dirtier as they age. So I don't know of any gas car that doesn't get dirtier as it ages. You know, it starts off, these days, gas cars are really clean relative to the way they were back in the 60s and 70s. But still, over time, the catalytic converter wears out, the engines start wearing out, and the pollution starts getting greater coming out of the tailpipe. With an electric car, it's just the opposite. It never gets dirtier, it only gets cleaner because the grid's getting cleaner. And that's a very important point. And of course, you can charge from solar at home. And by the way, we've done a recent survey, and 39% of the Leaf owners are using solar. And if you compare that to the average, national average, way less than 1% of the people in this country use solar energy. But the people with electric cars, they understand the PV-EV connection, photovoltaics and electric vehicles, very powerful combination economically. National security is the third big one. So we're clearly, we rely so much on other countries for our oil. And given that, the Iraq war clearly had something to do with oil. I'm not going to say it was 100% oil related, but there's hardly anybody in the country who would think that we would not have gone to war with Iraq if they had no oil. North Korea has no oil, and the leadership in North Korea starved to death 2 million of their people. But we haven't gone over there to deal with that. They got no oil. Iraq, they had a bad leader. But they also had the second largest oil reserves in the world. We went to war with those guys. 4,500 dead soldiers, tens of thousands wounded, 100,000 dead civilians, $1.5 trillion. Could we have used that money some other way? Could we have used those soldiers to do something else besides that? You bet. So the national security issue is a huge one. In addition, the RAND Corporation, which is a nonpartisan think tank, has been around since the 50s, and they conducted a very serious study on how much money we spend on military costs for protecting our access to oil. Turns out it's $80 billion a year. Now, this is exclusive of the war, so even if you are one of those few people who think that the Iraq war had nothing to do with oil, well, this is a cost that absolutely does have to do with oil, and nobody disputes that. Turns out $80 billion works out to about 55 cents a gallon. So when you go to buy gas, how much of that do you pay? Nothing. That's a big subsidy to the oil industry. So petro-dictators stifle production, productive peace negotiations. I mean, this has been well known for years. The people that run Saudi Arabia are as corrupt as any humans can be. They're misogynistic to a most radical degree. I'll give you an example of what happened over there just to tell you how much how you should feel about these people. There was a fire about 4 years ago in a girls' school, because they don't let boys and girls go to school together. So a girls' school caught on fire, and the fire trucks were called to come in. But the religious police got there first. They would not let the firefighters put the fire out and go in and save the girls, because they were men and they could not be around the girls. And so they let the girls burn to death in that building. And this happens all the time over there. That country is as corrupt as you can imagine. And the only reason they exist, those people exist, is because of the billions of dollars that we give them. Now, I don't know what's going to happen when their oil runs out, but their population is growing like crazy. They don't do their own work. They import workers from all over the world. They don't educate their own people. And so this is the whole Middle East is going to crumble at some point, and it's going to get very ugly, very nasty over there. But it all has to do with oil and their religion. And I'm not going to go into that area, but that's a whole nother discussion. Switching to domestic electricity from oil eliminates all of the above. Very clear. So from the perspective of national security, environment, and economy, it makes imminent sense to switch over to electric cars. Upstream costs and pollution, gasoline versus electricity. Now, if you look at the left-hand side of the slide, you see you've got extraction, you've got shipping, you've got refining, you've got distributing of the oil, you've got pumping of the gasoline into your gas tank, and then ultimately the burning of that. So every step of the way, there's pollution, there's costs, environmental costs, all these costs. With electricity, you know, you can either generate electricity from the standard way, burning coal, natural gas, hydro, things like that, or you can put solar panels on your house. And, you know, by the way, you know, I've had my panels now for 9.5 years, and we've been running our house and our car on sunlight for that long. Our electric bill averages about $100 a year for both the house and the car. Haven't been to a gas station since 2002. I've driven 104,000 miles on sunlight, and it's easy. So very big difference between the costs. So choosing the right EV for you. Well, when I used to give these talks, it was very frustrating because I'd get to this point and I'd be driving my Toyota RAV4 and people would see it outside. And it was an old car. It was when I first started talking, it'd be 4 years old, 5 years old, 6 years old. And I kept telling people, someday soon they're going to make new electric cars and you can buy them. Well, now I get to make these talks or give these talks and I can point to cars that you can actually go out and buy today. A lot more satisfying. You know, the two main ones that are on the market today are the Chevy Volt and the Nissan Leaf. I sell the Nissan Leaf, but I love the Chevy Volt. If I have a customer who comes in who says, you know, my drive cycle is I need to drive 80 miles, sometimes I drive 110 miles a day, or I don't know how far I'm going to go day to day, I tell them, you don't want a Leaf, go buy a Chevy Volt. Here's the name of somebody you can go buy. I won't direct them to another car on my lot, like a Versa. Versa would work fine for them, but it doesn't run on electricity. So I would send them to a competitor to buy another plug-in car before I'd send them to my own car lot to buy a pure gasoline car. So in addition to the Volt and the Leaf, you've got now the Mitsubishi iMiEV. I think they shortened the name to the Mitsubishi i. It's similar to the Leaf in that it's pure electric. The range is slightly less, more like 80 miles instead of 100. Top speed's a little less, acceleration's a little less, but it's on par. I mean, it's definitely in there, but the price is also a lot less. So the Mitsubishi is a really good value if you don't quite have enough money to get a Leaf. Ford Focus is coming out. They've delivered about 10. They're very slowly ramping up, but by the end of the year, you should be able to buy one in some of the major markets, and by, you know, this time next year, you should be able to buy them anywhere in the country. In addition, you've got Volvo, Mercedes, every car company on the planet is either in production or in development on electric cars and plug-in hybrids. So the variety and the number of vehicles available to you is going to grow very rapidly from this point on. Our Tennessee plant for Nissan by the way, all the electric cars that Nissan makes right now are coming out of Yokohama. They're making about 50,000 a year, but all that production is going to Asia, Europe, and the US, so we don't have a lot of cars coming in yet, and they're all being bought as fast as they come in, pretty much. But in Tennessee, we have a 5 million square foot plant that makes 8 Nissan products, and they're building a really large battery factory right outside the back door of it. That comes online in December, and the Nissan plant in Tennessee is going to make 150,000 Leafs a year starting, you know, the end of this year. So you'll be able to literally go into any Nissan dealer and pick a color and drive off that day. There's no waiting. So that's a big change. So you've got, you know, the plug-in hybrid electric vehicle like the Volt. So if you have to go long distance, or you want one car for the family so you can do electric driving during the day but long distance, then the Chevy Volt's the car, or at least that technology is the technology you want. The Volt is the first one, but Prius is coming out with their plug-in. Well, it's out now in Southern California, but it'll be out around the country by the end of the year. And so what that has is it's got a smaller battery pack than the pure battery electrics. And so you can drive all your daily driving on electricity, but it's got a generator in there so that if you do want to go farther than, say, the 40-mile range of the Chevy Volt, then you're going to burn gasoline, but that car can then take you to New York or LA or wherever you want to go. You just would burn gasoline at that point. Still very efficient overall. And a lot of the Volt owners that I know, they take pride in not using any gasoline. So a few of them have had theirs for over a year now. They've driven, say, 15,000 miles. And they say, oh, I've gotten 2 tanks of gas in an entire year plus, 2 tanks of gas. So that's pretty good. What's the payback for plug-ins? This is an issue that I really have a problem with. Whenever the media talks about electric cars, they say, well, what's the payback on that Leaf? It's going to take forever. You know, that Volt costs a lot of money. It's going to take years to pay back. No, there's no payback period. What's the payback on a Hummer? What's the payback on a Lexus? What's the payback on a Yugo? It's a question that's never asked. So why do they ask it of electric cars? Well, what they're trying to do, the media isn't asking the question. It was originally asked by the oil companies. Their PR people put that question out there as a meme into the general discussion on electric vehicles because they wanted to make electric vehicles look bad. So when they talk about the payback for the Volt, they compare it to a Chevy Cruze. When they talk about the payback for the Leaf, they compare it to a Versa. Well, I've driven both of those cars. They're not in the same league. So it's like comparing a Mercedes S-Class to a Mercedes Smart Car. They're both made by Mercedes, but you wouldn't compare the two because they're completely different cars. You get in a Chevy Volt, that car's fast, it's silent, it's smooth, handles like a sports car. Same thing with the Leaf. These cars should be compared to BMWs, to Lexus, to cars of that nature. You know, I'll give you a very good example is Toyota's, what's that main Toyota car? Camry. The same chassis is what the Lexus is built on, or at least a couple of the Lexus models. Now, would you say what's the payback on the Lexus versus the Camry? No. No, it's a different quality car, different quality ride. They're quieter, they're smoother. And therefore, you pay more for that. So the whole idea of a payback, not an issue at all. The reliability of an electric car, by the way, is outstanding. I had my Toyota RAV4 for 8.5 years. I just recently sold it. I drove it 91,000 miles. And the entire time, the only thing I did to it was change 2 of the shock absorbers. And that was it. The car ran perfectly the day I sold it. It ran just like the day I bought it. So there was no degradation whatsoever. Why pay more for plug-ins? Well, they're inherently better. You know, they have a unique, superior driving experience, as I've mentioned, very low cost of operation. People will give you free electricity. You don't have to take it, they'll give it to you. I go to a grocery store because they have a charger out there and they let me charge the car. I go to the manager's office when I'm leaving and I said, I just spent $80 in your store because of that charger. He's happy because I took 30 cents worth of electricity, but you know, he made a lot more profit off of me. And I'm happy because I could have gone to another grocery store and paid the same for the same food, but I wouldn't have gotten a free charge. And by the way, I measured it, and when I leave home, I check how much energy is in my battery. I go to the store, I plug in, I shop, I come back home, and I've got more energy in my car than I left with. That's a really nice thing. I like that. Shopping centers are putting them in, movie theaters, any place where you're going to be for a little while are starting to install chargers. In California, we've got thousands of them now, and they're growing very rapidly. I mean, every day there's another 50 or 100 going in. They're just really starting to pick up speed. Minimal maintenance, as I already mentioned, 100% domestic energy, can be 100% renewable, no war ever fought over electricity, guilt-free driving. And by the way, I ask people, do you ever feel guilty about driving? And most of the time they say no. And then I start telling them about the deaths from pollution, the wars, and things like that. I ask them the question again. They feel a little guilty. But you don't want to push them too much until there's an alternative. Because years ago, you'd say, there's really no alternative. You had to buy gas, and you really do have to drive a car, unless you have good access to mass transit. But nowadays, you have an alternative. So if you do feel guilty about polluting other people's air, sending soldiers to die for your cheap gas, things like that, then now you've got an alternative. And you can buy an electric car and eliminate all of that guilt from your driving. So since Obama became president, and I'm very political, by the way. If some of you are Republicans, that's fine. And you can ask me questions about this. But I'm definitely a liberal progressive, and Obama made a lot of this stuff happen. He wasn't alone in it, but he definitely had a lot to do with it. Since Obama became president, the U.S. grid has gone from 53% coal down to 39% coal. And that's primarily due to him enforcing the already on the books laws that the EPA was not enforcing during the Bush administration. What that meant is if a coal plant had to upgrade its equipment to repair it, then by law they had to upgrade to the newest pollution equipment. And Bush never enforced that law, so the coal plants never did it. Well, Obama is enforcing that law, and so a lot of the coal plants are just shutting down because they can't afford to upgrade, or they're switching to natural gas, which is slightly cleaner. And so because of that, we've shut down a lot of coal plants, and it's our best guess that within 20 years, all the coal plants in the U.S. will be gone. And they're not building new ones, by the way, because they're too expensive relative to the natural gas plants. Since Obama became president, we've installed 27 gigawatts of wind energy and 3 gigawatts of solar energy on the U.S. grid. That's enough clean, renewable energy to power 25 million electric cars. We've only got about 25,000 on the roads today, and that came in the last year and a half. So we're going to be installing new renewable energy, primarily wind and solar and some geothermal, and some new hydro. You've got a dam here in this state that used to generate power and long ago quit generating power. You could go back in and put a new generator in that thing, generate a lot of clean energy. The dam's already there. The environmental destruction's already been done. Why not use that dam to generate clean power? It could be several megawatts. So they're going to be installing a lot more solar and wind and geothermal onto the grid way faster than the new electric cars will be demanding that. So again, the grid will get cleaner as we go on. Now, here's the big one. This is one, I just found this out about 2 months ago, and I love the statistic. So just in 1 year, due to many state and federal efficiency programs, we saved 112 terawatt hours of energy. Now, I did the calculations. When I heard that number, I said, this is a huge number. So I did the calculations, and based on 4 miles per kilowatt hour, I can drive my Leaf a full 400 billion miles. Now, it turns out that last year, the total miles traveled in this country were 3 trillion miles, and 400 billion is about 13% of that. So just for inefficiencies, we saved enough energy to eliminate 13% of the gasoline use in this country. And that's going to continue. That's real low-hanging fruit, by the way. When you drive around town at night, you'll see a lot of lights on. Definitely don't need all of them on. People's in their homes, they have TVs on, multiple refrigerators, fountains, swimming pools with pumps that they don't even use. But all this wasted electricity that if you weren't using it, you weren't wasting it, you could use it to power a car for all your driving needs. Okay, here's where we got to. So there's also been, and I might need some help getting this going. I think it's going to work. Oh, good. So we've had some pushback from Fox News, Rush Limbaugh, people like that, They try to conflate the electric car and renewable energy with Obama administration. So they want to eliminate Obama from a second term, and so they're trying to make anything negative about electric cars to paint Obama with that brush. So Neil Cavuto is a Fox News reporter, and he's been talking bad about the electric car for some time now. And I had heard about this, but I had no idea how bad it was till Media Matters put this together. So I'll show you. This is 3 minutes and 16 seconds.
Well, as soon as I heard you had to plug it in, I immediately said, oh, come on. The Volt is a joke.
Do you see this car you plug in?
Yes.
Dumbest thing I've ever seen.
Have you seen anyone driving a Volt?
I have a problem with any car you plug in.
I'm excited about the Chevy Volt.
I am the crew.
I'm telling you, that is the dumbest car I've ever seen to be. Someone bought off Motor Trend. Someone bought off Motor Trend to set out his car to your.
Do you like the Volt, by the way? That is just a piece of. I will never drive a car you plug in.
One of the things.
You know that you're that stupid.
Even with the $7,500 rebate, whatever you get for it, it's still beyond pricing for essentially a Fred Flintstone car.
I just think on so many levels, it is stupid. It's the car you have to plug in like it's a big old matchbox thing. Plug in things that look, they look like something Ken and Barbie would squeeze themselves into. And people are saying, goofy, stupid, you would not drive a car that you have to plug in. Tell the truth.
Surely you cannot be a fan of that car.
The car magazine guys, they just love their car. Listen.
I have a problem with anything you have to plug in.
Yeah,
so that's just, I just think this whole car was like roller skates with a plug. When more people saying you got to be a dolt to buy a Volt, I mean, a vehicle you have to plug in, the American people have already weighed in on this and say it's stupid. You're the hotshot executive, and you are a hotshot executive, and you're told, we got a car for you. It's a Volt. You're going to puke. All right, from Volt to just revolting, the price tag that is heavy from Chevy, from going green to maybe just seeing green. So why can't they make a movie where the kids are stuck in a Chevy Volt and they're slowly suffocating? All right, well, here's another reason to hate this damn plug-in. My wife would forget to plug it in. And then she said, I thought you were going to plug it in. No, you were going to plug it in. There is no way in hell this car will be a success.
Also,
one of us forgets to plug the damn thing in. That's going to lead to a divorce.
Yeah, it's the dumbest idea.
Well, the more
my wife would forget to plug it in. It depends on people remembering to plug it in. It's going to lead to a lot of divorces, a lot of marital fights. You're going to have spouses arguing back and forth. It's going to lead to a lot of fights among couples. Honey, I thought you were going to plug it in. No, I thought you were going to plug it in. I thought you plugged it in. I thought you plugged it in. No, I thought you plugged it in. Why didn't you plug it in? I thought you plugged it in. No, I was supposed to plug it in.
And 80% of the people who lost them ended up getting divorced. I just made that.
Now, some people that have driven electric cars, including a staffer here, says that they actually prefer that. They just plug in at night, and they can just keep passing by gas stations as they're driving during the day.
And so they They don't forget to plug it in at night. Rick, I don't believe them.
Matter of fact, I personally drive a Chevy Volt.
You do not.
I personally drive a Chevy Volt.
The car you plug in?
Yes, I do.
That is the dumbest thing I've ever seen.
I strongly disagree with you.
You might know cars, but I watch car commercials. It looks stupid.
It's the best handling car.
You plug it in!
So that gives you an idea of what we're up against. And there's another one. Now, that's been going on. It wasn't just Neil Cavuto. Rush Limbaugh, several other of the people on Fox News were doing the same thing. And it really upset GM, particularly Bob Lutz. Now, Bob Lutz, if you don't know, he's Mr. Car Guy. He flies his own jet aircraft, military jet. He was a Marine. And he's run many car companies and been involved at a high level. He thinks he's famously quoted as saying that global warming is a crock of shit. And so he's not a global warming guy. He's not a green guy at all. He is a conservative individual. And he got really mad at what these guys were saying about the car that he championed, that he brought to market. And so we suspect, let's see, I just need to get back to. Right there. Oh, there we go. So, oops, back up. So, we suspect that Bob Lutz and some of the other GM people went and talked to Fox News because they were depressing the sale of that car I can tell you for sure they depressed the sale on my cars as well, because people were thinking, oh, this car's going to blow up, you know, because they were talking about the Volt fire that happened. And just to give you a background on the Volt fire, NHTSA, National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, crash tests every car sold in this country. That's what they do. And they crash tested the Volt, side impact with a pole at 40 miles an hour, took a forklift, turned it upside down to simulate rolling over, nothing happened. They studied it, photographed it, boom, okay, put it in storage. This is what they do with every car. Now, protocol is that when you crash a car and you put it in storage, you drain the gas tank before you put it in storage. Because what idiot would leave a full gas tank in a crashed car in storage? It could cause a fire. Well, protocol for an electric car is you disconnect the battery and drain the battery of its energy. There's a lot of energy in there. They didn't do that. They put it in storage. 3 weeks later, some fluid leaked out, some coolant leaked out, and ignited a fire in the battery compartment. Fox News took that and ran with it. Volt explodes on contact. And they ran with that for months. They were playing that, to the point where it was all over the news. People were talking about these exploding electric cars. And they didn't mention the fact that over 200,000 gas cars catch on fire every year. They kind of let that aside. So anyway, so that's what they did. And they were really hurting the sales of the Volt in particular. So Bob Lutz went and talked to them. And what we suspect he said, and some friends of mine actually interviewed him, and he alluded to this. He said, you know, we had to stop them, so we essentially threatened to pull all of our advertising from Fox. Here's what happened. Here was an interview right after that. Oh, shoot. There we go. This is the first time ever that Fox News, oh shoot, we have to go through, well, we got to go through a commercial. My apologies for that. You can't get straight into it. But this is the first time on record that Fox News has ever said anything positive about electric cars. And it was particularly telling because of the way they did it. They've got this Dallas businessman by the name of Lee Speakerman, who has been on Fox before. He's been interviewed many times, and he was taking issue with what they did with the Chevy Volt.
Welcome back. The Chevy Volt, pictured right here, has had a rocky start, but despite some sagging sales and some other issues, our next guest says it's a great car that's gotten a bad rap, all because of President Obama's record, perhaps. Joining us right now from Dallas this morning is Lee Speakerman, CEO of Speakerman Media and Media entrepreneur as well. Good morning to you, Lee.
Thank you, Steve. Good morning to you.
What do you mean that the car's gotten a bad rap, almost guilt by association?
Well, you know, I'm a Texan. I love oil. I'm a drill baby drill guy, you know, and unfortunately, I love Fox News and feel like I'm kind of attacking my own family here because I love O'Reilly. I love Neil Cavuto. I love Eric Bolling. But like a lot of my fellow conservatives, they seem to have kind of a fetish for demonizing the Volt, and they're perpetuating this myth that the Volt was some kind of Obama administration green energy fantasy that, as you say, was forced on General Motors during the bailout. It had been in development 2 years before Obama was elected, and it was championed by one of the greatest car executives in American history, Bob Lutz, who's a conservative and a climate change skeptic. So, you know, it's a myth. The tax break for buying the Volt was implemented by the Bush administration. That was not something that occurred under the Obama administration. So unfortunately, there have been a lot of myths perpetuated. Do you know, Steve, if you live in Ohio and have a Volt, do you know where the electricity is going to come from for that Volt?
Coal?
You got it. That exotic green energy fuel known as coal.
Right.
The great thing about the Volt is it is the quickest and most efficient way to bring American fossil fuels like natural gas and coal and nuclear power to American automobiles.
Right.
And I don't understand what's so conservative about wanting to send $35 billion a year to Hugo Chavez's Venezuela for his oil, or to send $70 billion to Middle Eastern OPEC countries. I don't see how that's conservative. We're propping up the world oil price, which is giving Iran the resources it needs to develop nuclear weapons. Indirectly, it's funding Hezbollah and Hamas and terrorists that are trying to kill Americans. We've simply got to stop this, and the Chevy Volt is by far the best way to bring all American energy, not just renewable sources, which is terrific and great for the environment, but our coal, our nuclear, our natural gas, which we have a prodigious amount of, to our automobiles. There's no real efficient way to do it other than by electrifying automobiles.
Lee, I'm glad you brought up the myth that so many people think that Barack Obama, you know, came to office and shoved this down GM's throat. It had been in development for at least 2 years, as you detailed. You also talked about how much energy we could actually save by using the volt. We've got a big graphic over here that people can see. As you can see, if there were 30 million volts on the road over 10 years, you'd save 694 million barrels of oil each year, 103% of oil imported from the Mideast or OPEC. So we certainly would be more independent than we currently are from Hugo Chavez. But you say this is a national security issue, don't you?
Well, absolutely. I mean, again, as I said, we're propping up the world oil price. I mean, we do need a lot more production, but what we should do, as Newt Gingrich has said, we can get gasoline down to $2.50 a barrel. That requires two things. One, a lot more American oil production. And part of the problem, unfortunately, is that the Obama administration's had pretty much of an anti-American fossil fuel agenda, and that has tainted the volt. But we also need to reduce the demand for gasoline. And again, the way to do that is to have a lot more Chevy Volts out there. And the Volt is a terrific car. I mean, frankly, it's the iPhone of the American automobile industry. It won the North American Car of the Year, the European Car of the Year, both in 2011, first time that's ever happened. It is the safest car on the road, according to the International Institute of Highway Safety.
Right.
So this is a wonderful vehicle. Look, I'm a 6'3" guy with a lead foot. You know, the last thing I want to do is drive an Econobox. Right. I've driven the Chevy Volt. It's a fantastic vehicle, very impressive. Over 5 years, you'll save a ton of fuel.
Sure.
There's a price differential, but at the end of the day, we really only need to get the Volt about 20% cheaper to make it comparable to the Chevy Cruze, which is the gasoline model.
There you go.
That's equivalent. And you know, look at flat screen TVs. They've come down 50% in 5 years.
Sure.
Computers have gone down 90%. So it would be a huge thing for national security. It's a great vehicle. And it's a great way to maximize American energy.
Well, you know what, Lee? I knew that I was going to talk to you today, and I went out and I test drove one on Saturday. You're right. It's a cool car, and it's smooth as glass. So people are interested in that kind of vehicle, check out the Chevy Volt. Lee Speakerman.
And see, one quick thing. It only needs two things, two options. A bumper sticker on the front that says, "Shove it, Hugo Chavez," and a bumper sticker in the back that says, "I'm driving an anti-terrorist weapon." That's all you need, and you've got a perfect car with a Chevy Volt.
You make a good point. All right, Lee Speakerman joining us today from Dallas. Thank you, sir.
All right, so I'm pretty much at the end of this. I've got a few more things there, but we're running out of time, so I did want to open it up for questions. So if anybody has any questions, I would very much like to hear them. Yes? Yes, as a matter of fact, quite a bit. Already, the FedEx vans, UPS, delivery vans for Frito-Lay, Coca-Cola, things like that, cars and or vehicles that have a prescribed route that is something less than 100 miles a day, and there are thousands of fleets with literally hundreds of thousands of vehicles that fit this model. And so they're going electric very quickly because the fleet people, they don't care. They don't have any politics involved or any of that. They look at the bottom line. They lease a vehicle for 3 years. What is the total cost? They don't look at the cost of the vehicle. They look at the total cost of operation, cost of the vehicle, everything. At the end of 3 years, how much? They look at the electric vehicle, and yeah, it costs a lot to buy, excuse me, but the cost of operation is really low. At the end of 3 years, it's cheaper than the gas version or the diesel version. So the mid-range vehicles, absolutely, they're going electric now. Long-haul truck, not going to happen for a long time because of the long distances needed. However, they are using hybrid technology in those, taking them from a 4 or 5 or 6 mile per gallon vehicle up to 7, 8, 9, which is, you know, still really bad mileage, but you're hauling a 40-foot trailer and several tons. So the efficiency gains are 30, 40, 50%. And so what we want to do is electrify what we can electrify easily, daily drivers, commuter vehicles. That's easy, low-hanging fruit. Let's electrify those. The gasoline saved from that can then be used for more important things, things that we can't electrify for a long time, even jet aircraft. Sir Richard Branson, he's got a big fleet of aircraft. He's putting $10 billion of his own dollars up to study biodiesel in jet planes. And they're making good progress on it. They're figuring out how to use it. And so over time, they'll be able to use some biofuels in the jet aircraft, which is by far the hardest thing to switch over to electricity. You're not going to see that. However, single passenger planes, two passenger airplanes, already electric. 4 years ago, they had a 20-minute range. Then a couple of years ago, it was a 40-minute range. Now they're almost 2 hours of range in electric airplanes. Yes? Yes, this is a good point. So she brings up the point, you're going to lose some jobs when you do the transition. You know, there are no more horseshoe people around. I mean, there's very few. It used to be a big industry, shoeing horses. Cars came in, that went away. So anytime you have a transition like this, there are winners and losers. The losers are going to be gas station attendants. Over time, it's not going to happen overnight, but over time that will happen. The other one are car mechanics. You know, again, it's going to take decades because we have 250 million internal combustion vehicles on the road today. They're not going away tomorrow. So anybody in auto mechanics now is probably assured of a job throughout their life. But if I was a high school student, I wouldn't be looking to get into that business. I'd look into installing solar panels or windmills or maintaining them or, you know, getting into electric vehicle production, that sort of thing. But here's the other side of it. Yeah, there's going to be some jobs lost over there. But if we're no longer sending $400 billion out of the country, and instead that money stays here, circulates through our economy, then we're going to generate a lot of jobs based on that, many millions more than what will be lost. But it is a good point. Correct, yeah, if we're not fighting wars. But the cost of fighting wars is much greater than anything you would lose by having those soldiers come back here and find jobs. Because if we had $400 billion, not only in the oil savings, but the $1.5 trillion that we blew in Iraq, you know, that would generate a whole lot of jobs here, and it would employ everybody.
Yes, we'll take one more question.
Sure. Because right now, I drive a 98 Jeep Cherokee that's paid for. It's mine. All I do is pay for gas.
Yep.
So.
Okay. Do you own a cell phone?
Yep.
Do you own a flat screen TV?
Yep.
All right. When those first came out, you couldn't afford those either. But now you can. Everybody can. And it's a matter of economies of scale. So right now, you can't afford to leave. But, you know, you could afford one in 3 years, 4 years, when they become used cars. You can buy one for $15,000. But there's no cost of operation. So a $15,000 car that is really sophisticated, you know, it's got great Bluetooth navigation, it's got all the toys of any modern American car, and but it runs on really cheap electricity. So if you bought that for $15,000 and it had enough battery life to last you another 7 or 8 years, that would be a good deal that probably you could afford. So yes, you're right. Today, not everybody can afford it, but you have to get from here to there. And the only way to do that is to get the people who buy these cars. Right now, the Leaf, after the incentives, is $30,000. The average price of a car sold in this country is $30,000. So at least, you know, half of the people can afford that. And you look at the Tesla Model S. It starts at 57, goes up to 87,000, depending on how much battery pack you want to buy. This is a phenomenally luxurious car that has a 0 to 60 of about 5 seconds. And yes, you can't afford that, neither can I, but there are millions of Americans who can. Let them buy those, and that money is then diverted into building the next Tesla, which will be a $30,000 car. And then Toyota and Honda and all these other people are bringing electric cars to market. Yes, the initial ones might be a little more expensive, but you get the quality of that ride. You know, the fact that you're not polluting somebody's air is very important to a lot of people. People will pay money for that. The fact that you're driving a car that doesn't use oil, over which we have to fight wars, people want to drive a car that does that. They're willing to pay more for that. But again, as we build more and more of these, get used ones on the market in a couple of years, and get lower cost ones, the Mitsubishi, you can pick that up for around 22 right now. 22 is getting down there, and that's a good car. So you're right, it's a very good point, but you can't buy one today, you can buy one in 2 or 3 years. But you have to get from here to there.
Okay, let's thank our speaker.